over there, send the word over there, that the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming, the drums, drums coming everywhere, so prepare, say a prayer, send the word to beware, we'll be over, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there. Johnny, get your gun.
Well, thank you for sticking around. And as you can probably tell from that first slide, this is a very low-tech presentation, okay? And what you see there is to supplement what I'm going to say. And pardon me if I read what I'm going to say, because it's the only way to get through the topic in 40 to 45 minutes. But I guarantee I'll be done at that time. Okay, welcome to an overview of the German naval mutinies of 1917-18. As Paul and I were talking earlier, everybody's heard about the German naval mutinies. Nobody's really sure what they signify, but all kinds of things have been said and attributed to them. East German historians lionized these mutineers as the forebearers of the social revolution that would be ultimately, though alas, not permanently, realized by the German Democratic Republic. As late as the 1960s, West German historians considered the mutineers to be traitors and nothing more. That's changed in Germany today. The question is, are either of these views valid? Is there something in between? Or perhaps were the mutineers motivated by more immediate concerns relating to their service? Now, we will examine these questions and we'll offer some answers. But I'm going to offer the most important conclusion right here at the beginning, and that is, we really don't have enough data. Despite all this time that has passed and all the available research that could have been done, not enough research has been done. That's one reason why we still don't know the true significance of these mutinies. We haven't been able, or we have not yet done enough research to positively resolve many of these issues. This became obvious to me in preparing for this talk. Now, we will come up with some tentative conclusions, and we'll note where more work especially needs to be done. But in part, I want to mention that we are dealing with impressions that have been accepted as facts. And one example is this photograph that's at the top of my introductory slide. Now, we'll see several similar photographs toward the end of the presentation. Images of German sailors in revolt that were seen around the world. But what's the reality behind those images? That's one of the things we're going to look at. So let's look at the available evidence that we do have. Yeah, we're going to consider three particular events or episodes. And each one of these could be a separate talk in and of itself, but don't give Paul any more ideas. First, the mutinies that were essentially, they were not confined to two battleships, but they were essentially on two battleships of the German High Seas Fleet in July, August 1917, rather quickly suppressed with the execution of two of the ringleaders. Second, the fleet mutiny that began October 28, 1918, spread to Kiel and then to Wilhelmshaven and other ports, and is often credited with sparking the general insurrection that then swept through Germany. And finally, the presence of the Volksmarine Division, or the People's Naval Division, in Berlin, November 1918 to March 1919. Is it the culmination of the revolution, or is it an epilogue? As essential background to the story of the mutinies, we need to remember both general and specific factors. Some of you may remember the presentation a couple of years ago by Joe and Janet Robinson on Imperial Germany. A society, we must remember, which was very much in flux, a nation that was far less united or homogeneous, I would argue, than Great Britain or France in 1914. This is reflected within the newly established Imperial German Navy before World War I, which is a battleship fleet led by officers from the upper middle class and manned by a mixture of volunteer but mostly draftee enlisted personnel from all over the nation. Now, regardless of their Navy experience, sailors carried with them the baggage of an incomplete nationalism, the grievances of class, and anti-Prussian particularism. An excellent example of this is furnished by Seaman Richard Stumpf, sailor aboard the battleship Helgoland, who left behind an excellent diary. Anyone read this? Outstanding book, outstanding. A diary of his service, which was later entered into the record of a post-war Reichstag, that's the German parliament, investigating committee that looked into the naval mutinies. Following the Battle of Jutland, Stumpf, who was a Bavarian Catholic, wrote the following in his diary after hearing a speech given by the King of Bavaria to the Bavarians in the High Seas Fleet. Quote, "It was obvious that the ruler of a landlocked state, Bavaria, could not be overjoyed that Prussia was the principal beneficiary of all our efforts. We South Germans are merely accorded the right to pay, but we get nothing in return. Not only are the ships built and provisioned in North Germany, but all the material is purchased north of the Main River. All of Germany was ecstatic over our victory at Jutland and hardly paused to reflect about the millions which Krupp and the shipyard made out of it. Thus, fractures within German society were carried over into the German Navy to begin with. As the war progressed and British blockade of foodstuffs tightened, the earliest and most persistent complaint of sailors in the Navy concerned the perceived and actual difference in food rations between the ordinary sailors and the officers. The belief, quite justified, that the officers were receiving much better food and drink than the sailors in a time of general want caused by the blockade. Of course, the officers on larger warships did enjoy better food, largely not because they were given greater rations, but because the officers received higher food allowances in their pay that they could therefore afford to go out and get higher provisions for themselves, as well as the fact that there were separate kitchens on board the larger warships to prepare separate food for the officers as opposed to the enlisted men. Here we have our first problem. These conditions prevail on battleships and battle cruisers, the capital ships, and to a lesser extent on the cruisers. But on the torpedo boats, destroyers, submarines, patrol craft, and minesweepers, everyone shared a common kitchen, and no one received special treatment. This is significant for several reasons, all of which deserve more research. First, precisely these categories of vessels, the torpedo boats, submarines, patrol craft, minesweepers, grew exponentially in numbers over the course of the war because of the unique demands of the sea war on Germany. While in contrast, the number of battleships and battlecruisers remained essentially the same. Second, it was precisely this tremendous growth in numbers of these small warships that drained off the best junior officers in the fleet, those who were on board the battleships and battlecruisers to serve in these new commands. And these officers drained off most typically represented the direct links on the battleships and battlecruisers originally between the enlisted men and the command staffs. So these junior officers who by their ability and by their ambition move and volunteer now for command of submarines, patrol craft, torpedo boats, they're replaced by officers of lesser caliber. Okay. Third, precisely these categories of small warships were most in contact with enemy forces, British forces, and suffered the vast majority of Navy casualties from June 1916 through the end of the war. And fourth, and most important, there were essentially no mutinies on these categories of small warships in 1917, 1918. Now, there's another area that demands more research. On the battleships and the battlecruisers, were all of the enlisted men equally disaffected? There aren't many photographs, unfortunately, of World War I German Navy personnel at their action stations aboard German warships. And here we see one of the relatively rare photos showing two helmsmen in the interior of an unidentified German ship. The man at the helm, given his function and his age, is probably an Obersteuermann, which is a navigator and a senior NCO in the German Navy. The younger man behind him, if you look at his right lower right sleeve, you'll see the two stripes there. He's probably an Obersteuermannsmat, which is a petty officer. Now, these two men represent, again, the Steuermann or navigator career track in the German Navy. They are the elite of the German Seamen's Division among enlisted personnel. What support do they offer to the mutinies? What's their position on the mutinies? We have no idea. No one's done any research. No one's done any research to identify within the German sailor class who was the most disaffected, who might not have been, who just went along. Now, here, by contrast, are those who are most commonly identified as the troublemakers in the German Navy, the Heizer, in German, stokers, in English, the stokers of the larger warships' engineering divisions. And remember, the majority of the German warships up to a certain point were all coal-fueled rather than oil-fueled. Ships commanding officers consistently marked these men, the Heizer, as the most disaffected among their crews. As an example, on November the 5th, 1918, the commander of the battleship Friedrich der Große stated that he forcibly transferred 60 to 70 mutineers off of his ship, all but three of whom were stokers. Only three men represented ordinary seamen. Therefore, we need to know more about these guys. Who were they? Where did they come from in Germany? What were their professional or father's backgrounds? Were they younger or older men? Do we know what they did after the war? To the best of my knowledge, these guys who we know are the troublemakers, no one's done any research. No one's tried to say, okay, let's look at this group specifically as a source of a major historical incident. No one's done it. Now, many of the records necessary for this may be gone. Destroyed during World War II. Certainly a lot of German records were lost then. But someone has to check. And here's one reason why. This is the cover of the principal literary work on the naval mutinies, Des Kaisers Coolies, or The Kaiser's Coolies. This book was published in 1930 by a writer named Theodor Plefier, as you can see up there. And it was translated, as someone, we talked earlier about the number of books that were published in the United States during the interwar years. This book was translated in 1932, published in an American edition. Plefier was not a stoker, but a former merchant seaman who was drafted into the Navy and who served on the German commerce raider Wolf during her epic raiding voyage from November 1916 to February 1918. Now, Plefier included his own account of his time aboard the Wolf in this book. But most of this book is a fictional account of the 1917 mutinies. Plefier's defense of the mutineers reflects his own personal radicalization. He will become a communist writer. He will spend World War II in exile in Moscow. And after the war, he will publish several novels about the Soviet-German War. Interestingly, he was not present. Although he was a member of the Navy, he was not present in the fleet at the time these mutinies took place, which didn't stop him from writing about it. The first major complaints about the disparity of food rations began in 1915, but the infamous turnip winter in Germany of 1916-17, when much of the potato crop failed, accelerated the problem through spring of 1917. Wildcat strikes began in June aboard several warships, but especially two battleships, the Prince Regent Luitpold and the former fleet flagship Friedrich der Große. The most serious strikes were on board the Prince Regent Luitpold. And there you see it there. In June, July 1917, there were two hunger strikes carried out on this ship, and they succeeded in winning some improvement in their food and in the concession of the establishment of a food complaint committee, which of course in German becomes one word, the Ménage à Commission. And that was the one of the achievements on board this ship, that they had one of these committees, which had been authorized earlier by the German Navy Department, but which had been very strongly resisted by the German High Seas Fleet Command. Moreover, ship's officers, in dealing with these wildcat strikes, they really didn't do too much. They really didn't punish anybody. They decided, we don't want word of this to get around. Let's deal with it quietly and hope it'll go away. This all changed on the evening of July 31st, when stokers aboard the Prince Regent Leopold were informed there would be no movie that night. Remember Mr. Roberts? The next morning, 47 Heitzer walked off the ship. Fortunately, they were in Wilhelmshaven Harbor, so they went ashore. Yes. This time, the captain decided on punitive action. He had 11 of the 47 arrested for punishment after they returned to the ship. And this was the standard. They'd have a walkout. They'd say, let's now go on strike. They'd go onto the shore. And then a couple hours later, they'd come back. No big deal, but it was a strike action, very typical of the kind of trade union action they had learned to exercise at home before the war as industrial workers. In this case, after they returned, 11 were selected for punishment, whereupon the majority of the crew, 600 men, staged a walkout strike on August the 2nd, again, going to shore. Their ringleaders were Johann Beckers and Albin Kürbis, both of whom were stokers. And they had already met with delegations from other warships in the fleet, especially the Friedrich der Große, for solidarity in whatever action they were going to take against the captain. It didn't come to that. The 600 strikers, they all returned within 3 hours, because you had to have 3 hours, if necessary, 3 hours minimum steam time to build up steam to be able to get underway. So they always knew they didn't want to avoid, they didn't want to break that law. So they all returned within 3 hours, and they were left with the impression by the captain that basically that was going to be it. There'd be no more punishment or anything like that. But the next day, 18 men were arrested, followed by arrests of more crewmen and of arrests of those men who had been in the strike delegations from the other warships who had met with the men of the Prince Regent Leopold. And this included the men from the Friedrich der Große. That was the former fleet flagship. And that was kind of a sticking point. If it's a former fleet flagship, you really are concerned about discipline on board. And here's where the proverbial shit hit the fan, yes. For the ringleaders on the Friedrich der Große had a different agenda than did Beckers and Kürbis on the Prince Regent Leopold. On the Friedrich der Große, the leaders of the disaffected sailors were stoker Willy Sachse and especially seaman Max Reichpeach, Reichpeach in particular added something new to the equation, a political direction. Far less interested in food complaints or grievances against officers, Reichpeach perceived far deeper problems in the German Navy and in German society. That, he felt, was the root cause. He opposed this extreme war aims program of the German government, and especially of the right wing. He favored domestic political reforms in Germany. And consistent with his views, he contacted representatives of the extreme left-wing party in the German Reichstag, the Independent Social Democrats, or the USPD, on their German initials. And ignoring the express cautionary advice of those representatives, Reichpeach disseminated the party's publications among his shipmates. And he met with delegations from other crewmen of other ships to spread the word about his political ideas and how the USPD would help carry them up. Talked up the party program. And mentioned the possibility of organizing a general strike within the fleet if necessary. Now, when Navy investigators began tracing the links to the delegations on these other ships, they first picked up Reichpeach's co-ringleader, I mentioned earlier, Willy Sachse. Sachse immediately spilled his guts, told everything he knew, and blamed everything on Reichpeach, which Reichpeach didn't deny, nor did he try to conceal his links to the Independent Social Democrats. This political connection served as a red flag, literally, to Fleet Commander Vice Admiral Reinhard Scheer. We see here. Remember, I used him in my last presentation. Scheer had been willing to downplay the episode, just as had happened previously with the Wildcat strikes, and he wanted to do so with minor punishments. But the links to the USPD changed the picture entirely. Scheer and his officers now accepted as gospel a plot by the Independent Social Democrats to foment mutiny and rebellion in the fleet and undermine the entire German war effort. This marks, by the way, the real beginning of the stab in the back legend. Doesn't really happen after the war, it starts here. Later, the Navy would spearhead an effort to have the USPD banned entirely from the Reichstag, made criminal, and its leaders should be arrested as traitors. All those efforts would fail. But in August, Scheer proceeded directly against the sailors implicated in the mutiny. 75 men were court-martialed. Their trials were marked by judicial shortcuts and violations of standard German Navy jurisprudence. If we have time in the question and answer, I can go into some details of that. About 3 or 4 men were acquitted, all the rest convicted, and 5 sentenced to death. Now, Scheer will commute 3 of them, 3 of these death sentences to life, but 2 men, Albin Kürbis on the right of the Prince Regent Leopold and Max Reichpeach on the left of the Friedrich der Große, 1 ringleader from the 2 offending ships, and see to it that they were executed outside Cologne on September 7th, 1917. What you see underneath there, a little statement, they acted or conducted themselves as socialists among their comrades and died as victims of the Tirpitz mentality. In doing this, Scheer violated another legal safeguard, the right of appeal for clemency to the Kaiser. The execution of the sentences followed so quickly there was no time for appeal of these men to the Kaiser. The significance of this can be seen in the overall German record regarding military executions of their own personnel during World War I. If I had skills, I'd have a really flashy slide here with the numbers coming up dramatically and all that. But you just have to listen to me. In the French army in World War I, about 600 men were executed by their own authorities in the course of World War I. In the British army, it was 328. Can anyone guess what the number might be for militaristic Germany?
27.
No. Close. 48. 48. There were only 150 death sentences handed out to German soldiers during World War I, and most of those were commuted. Therefore, this is a statement being made by Scheer in rushing through with their executions to show there would be no nonsense tolerated. Interestingly, the executions were followed by a modest improvement of rations. And so the 1917 mutinies ended. They were, again, primarily concerned with food rations, the conduct of their officers, and mistreatment that they believed, that the sailors believed they had suffered. Only secondarily were they political. And it's important to note that at the end of the war and after the war, there was an attempt to identify exactly how many men had actually indulged in Reichspeitsche's views and had actually read the material and made some kind of commitment or signed lists that supported the USPD. And the number is about 5,000 out of 65,000 in the German Navy, okay? 7 to 8%. And the best post-mortem of the 1917 mutinies, you can see here. Now, can you read those? At the top, you have the testimony of Vice Admiral Adolf von Trotha, who had been a battleship commander early in the war and was chief of staff of the High Seas Fleet from 1916 to 18. And at the bottom, you have the comments of Willy Weber, again, both of them appearing before the Reichstag Investigating Committee in 1919. Weber was one of those who was convicted and sentenced to 12 years in prison in August 1917. But you see, they exactly concur. If everyone had had the same rations, as was the case on the smaller warships, we wouldn't be talking about this. The improved rations did not last. They did not last long, anyway. But a relative calm prevailed for over 1 year. But a new crisis developed in mid-October 1918 as Germany approached both military defeat and, finally, parliamentary democracy. The new chancellor, Prince Max von Baden, acceded to President Woodrow Wilson's demand that Germany suspend all submarine attacks on passenger ships as a precondition for the armistice. Scheer opposed this entirely, and with such vehemence that the new chancellor, and Prince Max had only become chancellor on October the 3rd, and 12 days later he's having this climactic meeting with Reinhard Scheer and General Ludendorff as well, the chancellor had to threaten to resign in order to exact compliance from Scheer to suspend these U-boat attacks on passenger ships. Scheer then ordered the cessation of all U-boat commerce operations, which went beyond Wilson's demands. But more ominously, Scheer informed the Prince Max that in doing this, quote, the Navy would regain complete operational freedom for the High Seas Fleet. The Chancellor should have immediately asked, what do you mean by that? But he didn't, at least not according to Scheer's memoirs. And the stage was set for the final act. Now, what followed has been debated as more of an admiral's rebellion than it was a sailor's revolt, as this 1933 book cover illustrates. You see the fracture being used for the admirals and the more common Zuderlin writing style for the sailors' revolt. What is certain that by early October of 1918, plans had already been drawn up for a fleet operation in the North Sea to draw the British fleet into one last battle. This goes back ultimately to Tirpitz and his original idea in building the fleet that might inflict such heavy losses on the British as to at least bring about more favorable armistice terms, even though this might well involve the destruction of the entire German fleet. Carefully avoided in these plans was any consideration of the political importance, as Germany's new chancellor, again, Prince Max, who's only been in the job since the beginning of October, was in the middle of delicate peace negotiations directly with Wilson. And a sudden foray by the fleet not only threatened to undermine those negotiations, but would reveal that the new chancellor was not in control of the armed forces. And in this sense, you can certainly make the case that Scheer's operation does indeed equal an admiral's rebellion. Now, the operation has often been described as the death ride of the high seas fleet. And here's a map that was prepared showing exactly what the plan involved. Actually, as death rides go, this was pretty tame, as the map kind of indicates. You can see that the bulk of the fleet, which is three here, number three there, the bulk of the fleet was never going to be that far out into the North Sea. It would hope to entice the British fleet to come quite a distance south, moving through U-boat patrol lines and freshly laid minefields in their path. If the British didn't bite, then torpedo boat flotillas would undertake a truly dangerous thrust north as further bait. Whether the British would ever have obliged the Germans is rather doubtful, though some people consider it as possible. What ultimately mattered were three considerations. First, Scheer and the High Seas Fleet Command were willing to accept the risk of the destruction of the fleet. They knew that was the worst case scenario, and they were willing to accept it. Second, the fleet's officers openly discussed the great risk of this sortie and the possibility of this being an honorable suicide. And three, the fleet's ordinary sailors overheard these remarks by the fleet's officers, which then grew in the telling, compounded by rumor, into what was a surefire kamikaze run, a Yamato run set, 27 years before. The sailors were, of course, aware of ongoing negotiations between Germany and the Allies, and they believed that peace was almost at hand. The rumors of an imminent fleet operation aroused widespread suspicions among the sailors of an effort to overthrow the new government and sabotage those negotiations. Thus, on October 27th, 1918, as the unmistakable signs of preparations for a fleet departure began to take place, the first sailor opposition appeared. They refused to light the boilers. And again, there was communication from one ship to the next. We're going to do this. You're going to do this too? Right, we're going to do this. And even greater passive resistance, in some cases, the crews would barricade themselves in a certain section of the ship and not come out. In some cases, they manned one of the batteries and threatened to fire the gun turrets on selected targets, that is, any ship that actually would proceed. Over the next 2 days, this resistance basically paralyzed any hope of moving the fleet. This affected all of the battleships, all the battle cruisers, and some of the cruisers. The fleet command had to first postpone and then cancel the operation, while ships commanders actually had to meet with deputations from the crews. The records of these conversations, which again we have at the archives, include the paradox of mutinying sailors defying their officers and defending their actions as the true representatives of the government. There's also a fascinating remark by a mutineer aboard the battleship Helgoland to her captain on October 31st, quote, "Had the fleet attempted such an operation 5 months ago, we would have understood." Again, this is not something that is set in stone. It is relative to the time that it takes place. And the sailor's remark raises a very interesting question. Why didn't the high seas fleet attempt, if this is a suicide operation, why didn't they attempt something like this earlier in 1918, at the time of the height of the German army's summer offensives, when an operation of this might actually have achieved something, or at least some coordination? Unfortunately for the Germans, German Navy and German Army operations, no one thought at all about ever coordinating anything. The mutiny spread to Kiel due to an ill-advised decision by the fleet command to send the 3rd Battleship Squadron there. The 3rd Squadron included some of the most hardcore mutineers, but what seems to have escaped much historical analysis is the role of the Navy's shore establishment in Kiel. The evidence suggests, though again it has not really been examined, is that many of the sailors stationed in Kiel in the shore establishment had become even more radicalized than the sailors on the fleet, particularly in the 1st Torpedo Division. And they are supported by radicalized civilian workers in the shipyard. And again, no one has drawn the links to establish, well, how much of this is the guys on the fleet? How much of it is the guys on shore? Mutinies on board ships are much sexier than mutinies in land-based installations. And that may be one reason. In any case, it was a mixed group of mutineers from the 3rd Squadron battleships and the 1st Torpedo Division who marched through Kiel on the evening of November the 3rd to free their comrades who'd been arrested and jailed from the fleet. They were fired on by a mixed Navy-Army patrol, killing 8 men, wounding 39. With that bloodshed, more men joined the mutiny, and the fleet and basically Kiel effectively fell into the mutineers' hands, and followed from there by Wilhelmshaven retroactively. Interestingly enough, the mutiny broke out with the fleet in Wilhelmshaven, but it doesn't spread to the city. They send a squadron of ships to Kiel, and in Kiel, that's where everything explodes. And then it comes back to Wilhelmshaven, where the rest of the fleet has been, but there's been no connection with the town there of a mutiny or of a revolt. Again, something that's worth studying. Why Kiel? Why not Wilhelmshaven? Worthy studies. There was one major act of violence aboard ship when mutineers demanded that all ships haul down the imperial ensign. If you don't know what that looks like, check my tie here. And the German Imperial Naval Ensign, which today is used by neo-Nazis in Germany, because I can't wave the Nazi flag. That's illegal. So they've borrowed the Imperial German Naval Ensign from World War I, and that's the new symbol of neo-Nazi types in Germany today. That's not yet been banned. But in any case, that was the Imperial Ensign, and all the ships were ordered by the mutineers to haul down that flag and run up a red flag. The commander of the battleship Koenig refused to do so, and on November 5th, a mutineer went aboard the ship himself, chopped down the Imperial Ensign, whereupon Captain Venegar, commander of the battleship, shot and killed the mutineer, and he was then in turn gunned down by rifle fire from the mutineers along with 2 of his adjutants. Yet, despite that, there was no real large-scale violence in Kiel, which is evident from this list of 14 demands by the Kiel Sailors Council issued on November the 4th. Look especially at item number 9, the council to take immediate measures to protect private property. Not exactly a Leninist manifesto, I would say. And you can see there, most of those issues are very, very pragmatic, and they go back to the issues of the relationships with the officers on board the fleet and other practical matters. It's also important to realize that not all the units of the high seas fleet joined in the mutiny. There were 16 U-boats stationed off Helgoland in early November to protect the coast while all this is going on. In fact, we talk about that operation being aborted, but in fact, 25 U-boats sailed as part of that operation, and two of them were sunk in connection with this operation that never took place. Well, for those two U-boats that were lost, basically with all hands, the operation did take place. The commanders of cruiser Bremse and several torpedo boats reported no onboard disturbances whatsoever, and they only brought down the Imperial flag under threat of fire from mutinying battleships. The crew of destroyer V-71 interned themselves in Sweden rather than go to Kiel. The fourth torpedo boat flotilla complied with the red flag order, but they did so by flying a red streamer, that is something, you know, a foot or two in height, several feet long, by flying that underneath the Imperial flag. And they got away with it. Apparently no one noticed. And the crew of destroyer T-33, whose captain was on temporary duty in Jena, mounted and maintained an armed guard to protect their captain's family and home in Kiel from any damage or attacks by mutineers. Into this not-so-revolutionary situation stepped Gustav Noske, whom we see here, a leader within the ruling majority Social Democratic Party. The independents had split off from the majority Social Democrats. They're the ones who are very much pro-peace. The Social Democrats pretty much kept in line, although they opposed any annexationist programs, but they basically stayed part of this mainstream system throughout the war. And this gentleman, Gustav Noske, was sent by the chancellor, who was still Prince Max von Baden, to Kiel to negotiate an end to the disturbances. Within days of his arrival on November the 4th, Noske was accepted by the mutineers and elected as chairman of the Kiel Sailors and Soldiers Council. And pretty soon he's master of the situation in Kiel. And he actually gets the men to start obeying their officers again. There's no better illustration that Noske, and not the sailors, represented the revolution, which is to say, at least the opinion of many historians, there really wasn't much revolution in 1918 to talk about. The epilogue to the mutinies followed the next month in Berlin. The new interim government and its chancellor, Friedrich Ebert, relied for its military support on the Volksmarine Division, or People's Naval Division, which was organized in November 1918 from among the mutinying sailors in Kiel who were sent to Berlin, along with sailors who were already in Berlin, plus others, to provide the basic military force for the new government. They were based in the Stadtschloss, the imperial castle in the heart of Berlin, and they secured the government quarter. These images, which were circulated throughout Germany, cemented the link between revolutionary sailors and revolutionary government in the public mind. But were they really sailors? Well, not according to historian Rudolf Köper, whose research, which you can read here, indicates that only about maybe one quarter of the Volksmarine Division were actually sailors. Apparently a great many others were ex-army men who believed in the cause, believed in the revolution, and became de facto members. They were in Berlin already, and they joined the Volksmarine Division. This unit quickly wore out its welcome with its unruly conduct, resulting in the withholding of their pay, which led in turn to their seizure of the chancellery and the temporary house arrest of the chancellor, Friedrich Ebert, by the People's Naval Division on December 23rd. The next day, they also successfully resisted a half-hearted attempt by regular army troops to dislodge them. This was their brief moment of glory, as they also received their back pay. In the Spartacist uprising of January 1919, however, which is just a month later, when communist forces attempted to seize Berlin, the Volksmarine Division basically sits it out. They don't really participate as a unit in the January fighting, as the Social Democratic government under Friedrich Ebert, now with Gustav Noske as his defense minister, turned to a brand new type of military force. They realized, after bringing in regular army troops who are looking to be demobilized, the war is over, they want to go home, they're really not all that excited about fighting communists in Berlin. Well, they find groups of men who are enthusiastic about fighting communists in Berlin, a group that is called, and we know through history, as the Freikorps. These volunteer units, composed of right-wing young army and navy veterans, perhaps best known as freebooters, that was how basically they were known in Germany at the time, for their character and their ability to basically grab anything that wasn't nailed down. In March 1919, the Volksmarine Division was dissolved at the order of the government, and many of its leaders are executed by the Freikorps. And in concluding our discussion, we turn to the naval dimension of the Freikorps, where Navy officers gained a measure of vengeance for the mutinies. Now here we see examples of Freikorps badges. Each one had their own unique badge, worn in the post-war fighting. Two of these, I wish I had a pointer, but you notice the ship in the upper, in the first row, number three, and notice the anchor with the wreath. Those two badges belong to two naval Freikorps. The badge on the top, the Viking ship, is for the 2nd Marine Brigade, organized by Navy Corvette and Kapitän Hermann Erhardt in Wilhelmshaven in January 1919. Again, originally consisted of Navy officers, seasoned Navy petty officers, university students, and then later hundreds of freebooters from a Baltic Freikorps, which had been disbanded after losing in the eastern part of Germany. They are absorbed into this unit, which becomes known basically as Freikorps Erhardt, after the commander. This Freikorps fought in Munich and in Silesia and participated in the Kapp-Putsch of March 1920, which tried to overthrow the Friedrich Ebert government, the government which had relied on these guys to help restore order. After the Kapp-Putsch fails, this unit is dissolved. The second insignia, the wreath, the anchor with the wreath, that belonged to the 3rd Marine Brigade under the command of Wilfried von Löwenfeld, and it becomes known as Freikorps von Löwenfeld. And here we see, in the upper right-hand corner there, three officers of that Navy Brigade, Freikorps, who commanded battalions, the three battalions in the Freikorps. This is a pretty big Freikorps. This Freikorps was organized in Kiel in March 1919 by Korvettenkapitän Wilfried von Löwenfeld, who had commanded a pre-dreadnought era battleship and later was a staff officer in the Navy High Command. Like the other Navy Freikorps, it was composed of young officers, seasoned petty officers, and naval officer cadets. It fought against the Poles in Upper Silesia in August of 1919, and it fought the communists in the Ruhr in February 1920. The three officers you see there, they mentioned all battalion commanders. The figure on the left is Korvettenkapitän Hans Kolbe. He had commanded a torpedo boat earlier in the war, Later, he was a commander of one of the torpedo boat half flotillas. The figure on the right, Captain Lieutenant Hermann von Fischel, who was a commander of two different U-boats during World War I and ended the war as an instructor with the submarine training school. And the figure in the center, for those of you who might be submarine or U-boat enthusiasts, is Capitaine Lieutenant Lothar von Arnaud de la Perrière, late of U-139 and the leading submarine ace of the German Navy and of all navies at this time. No one has ever equaled his total tonnage sunk as a submarine captain. Thus, the Imperial Navy, of the torpedo boats, the destroyers, and the submarines, ultimately had more say in Germany's political future than did the revolutionary sailors. Those of the latter who fought for a communist future failed. But for the vast majority of sailors who had mutinied aboard the High Seas Fleet in 1917 and 18, they achieved their most immediate and arguably most important political objectives, peace and the right to go home. Thank you. How about that? Questions? Yes.
What about the Royal Navy or other navies where there might have been a food differential between officers and enlisted personnel?
Yes, there always were. Every navy had food differentials. The problem was, in a time of want imposed by the blockade and food shortages, that was the idea. Why are these officers enjoying better provisions when everyone else is suffering? And German sailors in the fleet are very well aware of what the situation is with their families at home and how much they're suffering. That's what really sticks in their craw. Yes?
So the 1918 mutinies basically just petered out after Moscow.
Yes. Noska basically took it over. He, what's the phrase? He co-opted it. He co-opted the entire 1918. But by that point, you had something going on all over Germany, which is no longer a Navy mutiny now. You're talking about a mass popular uprising around Germany. But the basic form of government has already been determined. It's already made the transition. And that's what we often forget. Germany in October of 1918 made the necessary changes to a parliamentary government, which the Allies thought, well, that's just a smokescreen. We all know what they're just making some cosmetic changes. No, it was really a substantial reform that's going on. That reform is completed in November, once the Kaiser abdicates, which is a logical conclusion. They were going to keep the Kaiser originally as a figurehead. I don't think you could keep Kaiser Wilhelm as a figurehead. So his abdication completes the process. But basically, the reform had already been achieved. The irony is the government has to depend on right-wing nationalists who really have no loyalty to this government whatsoever. But the government has to depend on them to fight off the Spartacists and the communists. Yes?
Yes, earlier you said that the percentage of the sailors of the German Navy who would actually sign on to the revolution or taken some sort of action, you put it at 7 to 8%.
Right.
How is that ratio consistent? What's the representation of the independent social, the political party, the independent social?
Actually, that's about proportional to the independent social democrats in Germany at large. Yes.
What part of the Reichstag did they have?
Well, it changed over time, but it's not that many. I think it's about 20 to 25 seats. As per the German parliamentary system, they qualify. They're above the 5%. I think it's probably about 10% to 12%. But by 1918, they're starting to get more people. You see, at the time, 1917, of the mutinies, I'd say they're only about 10%. By October 1918, I'd say it's growing, but there hasn't been a recent election to reflect that. So that's the best answer I can offer. Yes.
In the United States Air Force, when people are brought in and they're given tests, people scored at the bottom will usually either make security cops or cooks. Okay? You have to assume that a stoker coming in, somebody winds up as a stoker in the German Navy swinging a shovel, pretty much at the bottom of the
Yes. A stoker is definitely, and that's not just characteristic of the German Navy. Remember the stokers in the British Navy, I don't think were much better, or in the British Merchant Marine. Remember there's a strike in 1912 at the time the Titanic sails among the stokers, which has some consequence for the Titanic in that there's a smoldering coal fire that's not been properly attended. But they may well have included, one of my points is, the Heitzer might well have been former coal miners. Coal miners are pretty organized. They may not be at the top of the food chain, but knowing that, they know there's some strength in numbers. So they organize. They organize in unions. And even though the German government of Kaiser Wilhelm does not like unions, they know it's a reality that they have to deal with. And that, I would argue, is one of the realities in the German Navy, that the Heitzer, although not very high, what have they got to lose, too? But they're organized, and that's what gives them some power in the Navy. Yes, Jeffrey.
Was the Kaiser at all behind the notion of the suicide run?
Had nothing to do with it.
That sounds like a Kaiser. You know.
Well, yeah, it does. In fact, the German Navy High Command considered perhaps we should invite the Kaiser to accompany us on this mission as a gesture of friendly loyalty and of mutual self-sacrifice. But they ultimately decided, no, let's not do that. And the publicity that would have gone with that would not have been good for the overall operation. But no, the Kaiser had nothing whatsoever to do with this. So entirely the local people. Anybody else? Yes.
Yeah, going back to this with the death ride, I assume from a previous presentation, I assume the British had picked it up from the German code messages, because they had flying boats out looking for them.
But the question of whether they knew exactly what was underway, exactly the extent of it, or where it was directed, that's a separate issue. The question of where the fleet was going, they undoubtedly had intelligence to indicate that the fleet was coming out. But keep in mind, too, what happened in April 1918. Remember my last presentation, those of you who saw it? In April 1918, the German High Seas Fleet steams to just off the coast of Norway, and the British fleet sits in port and says, huh, look at that. Think we should do something? And then gradually they start to come out, and the German fleet steams from the southern coast of Norway undisturbed back to German home waters. So there's always been an argument, how much did the British Navy want to tangle with the German fleet under terms where the German fleet would dictate how that action would take place. And what the British understood was that the Germans were going to set up minefields and U-boat patrol lines to cover their advance and their retreat, and that any British fleet sortie to try to get at the German fleet is going to run into those minefields and U-boats and lose a disproportionate amount of strength, or risk losing a disproportionate amount of strength in those areas. And therefore, it's not worth it. Because even if the German Navy, if the German fleet goes up to Norway, what's it going to do? Is it going to invade Oslo? No. It's going to go back afterward. And they did. So something to keep in mind. Yes.
Beatty's now the fleet commander, not Jellicoe.
Beatty was the fleet commander in April. And what did he do?
Nothing.
In fact, he does make a comment later, I would like to have one more go at them. In 1918. It sounds good, but
after he got the crap kicked out of him.
Yeah, Beatty did not distinguish himself at Jutland.
How many American battleships did the British get?
Pardon me?
How many American battleships served with the Grand Fleet at the end?
It was at least six, I believe. I think a reinforced squadron. But one of the interesting things is that American unit was scheduled to provide convoy escort, in the Norway to Shetland Islands convoy route in April of 1918. And if the dates had been a couple of days later, the German high seas fleet would have encountered American battleships escorting a Norwegian convoy to northern Britain. And that might have been interesting. There's one for your war games, for Strategy and Tactics magazine, to extrapolate what might have happened then. But not. That's another talk. Thank you very much.
There's the anchor coming, the anchor coming, the drum, drum coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer, send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there. Johnny, get your gun. Johnny, show the hug, you're a son of a gun. Hoist the flag and...